We've got three brilliant speakers here. On my left is Wolfie Crissel, who is a web developer, activist, researcher, social entrepreneur, game designer, you know. And artist. I'm only saying what, you know.
I have to change it.
But this is a really good thing. He says he studied but did not complete degrees in art, computer science, sociology, and media studies. But the best thing about Wolfie, he's co-written this book called Networks of Control, and he's going to give us an overview today on the corporate use of big data and profiling. And on my right, on that table, we've got Frederick, I can't pronounce it.
Zuidervan Borgesius.
Zuidervan Borgesius. He's a researcher at the Institute for Information Law at the University of Amsterdam. And he's written a book on improving privacy protection in the area of behavioral targeting. And he's a fantastic expert in this area. And last and not least, Jeff Chester, who is the executive director of the US Center for Digital Democracy, a Washington DC nonprofit. And it's one of the leading NGOs advocating for consumers on digital privacy. And he was very much single-handedly responsible for introducing the Children Online Privacy Act and other wonderful things. So welcome all, and I'll give the word to Wolfie, who will give us an overview of the programmatic area, yes?
Yes, thanks a lot. My name is Wolfie Crissel. I'll take you to a high-speed tour through some of my research. First of all, who of you knows what a DMP is, or some of these other terms? Show me. Okay, nearly nobody. This is what marketing people use when they're talking about programmatic advertising, which is basically about selling our profiles in real time to whoever pays most. Digital profiles based on our interests, behaviors, for example, based on the websites we visit. This is Livebeam. I visited 5 websites here. In the background, these 5 sites connected to 118 third-party services and told them about my visit. This is about how thousands of tracking companies are able to compile profiles about our online behavior. And there's also our smartphone. This is a pretty nice map of third-party trackers on Android. Apps, the blue circles represent the apps, the orange ones in the center, the third-party services. But back to Livebeam, let's have a look at 2 third parties who tracked me. Let me introduce you to AddThis and BlueKai. BlueKai is a so-called data management platform. They both belong to Oracle, the world's largest business software provider. Oracle acquired several data companies in recent years. BlueKai, an online data marketplace, Datalogix, which has partnerships with stores and loyalty programs, and AddThis, which is harvesting behavioral data from 15 million different websites. These companies are now integrated in Oracle's data cloud. On this slide, Oracle explains that they record what consumers do, what consumers say, and what consumers buy. Oracle says it aggregates 3 billion user profiles, but also 700 million social messages daily, and billions of purchases in order to target people, personalize content, and to measure how people are interacting across platforms, channels, and devices. You can see here online, mobile, email, social media, to TV, radio, direct mail, and even in-store. And in the center, you can see the Oracle Identity Graph, which allows them to link and match user profiles across platforms, devices, and company databases in order to create one addressable consumer profile. Oracle also provides a wide range of data from partners. They provide share and combine data from data brokers like Axiom, Experian, TransUnion, Equifax. They also provide data from credit card companies. And of course, Oracle also partners with Google and Facebook. Facebook, a company which sorts nearly 2 billion people into thousands of categories and lets advertisers use these categories in order to include or exclude people from ads on an individual level. For example, advertisers can target people based on categories like Arabic language, Islam, online gambling, personality disorder, plus size clothing, stomach cancer, trade union, wheelchair, and many more. Since 2012, Facebook also partners with other data brokers to profile people better. For example, with Oracle, Experian, and Axiom, a large data broker which claims to have up to 3,000 attributes on 700 million people. For example, they have the credit history, the driving history, the criminal history, and so on. They don't collect data about illnesses of people, but about health interests. Another example for a large data broker is LexisNexis Risk Solutions, coming more from the risk side of personal data businesses, and they have offers like they're selling data on problem renters, they have got employment screening, also offers for healthcare, collect medical prescriptions, for example, they also have offers for governmental agencies. At the same time, they also provide some marketing solutions. And this is a general trend. The same data and the same analytics technology is more and more used in completely different contexts, from marketing to finance, insurance, health, and even law enforcement. Take, for example, Visual DNA. They use data from online quizzes to create personality profiles about users. Altogether, they provide digital profiles about 500 million consumers for marketing purposes, but also for credit scoring and risk assessment. Therefore, they partner with Oracle, Experian, MasterCard, and Admiral, a large UK insurer. So they cross the line between the contexts of marketing, data, and risk management. Another example, Signify, a company calculating credit scores from phone call records. They partner with large mobile network operators, and as you can see, telco marketing on the left, credit and finance on the right. In our report, we investigated much more examples like this, but okay, what if data would be used only for marketing? Marketing has and still is the major driver for pervasive corporate surveillance. In 2007, Apple introduced the smartphone. Facebook had only 30 million users. Online advertisers started to use individual level data to profile and target users. 10 years later, we've got thousands of companies in the field of so-called marketing technology or ad tech, which is largely based on personal data collection and profiling. Take, for example, Telepart, a so-called predictive marketing platform which has been acquired by Twitter. They claim to provide a so-called Telepart identity network, which incorporates massive amounts of data to create a Telepart identity key for each and every shopper. And then they calculate a customer value score for each shopper and product combination. As a result, some customers get personalized offers and others don't. Or even personalized prices. It clearly won't be a problem for somebody to miss a single ad or discount, but I think it's a problem on a structural level. Imagine someone experiences many of those small disadvantages every day, perhaps even without being aware of it. Personalization based on our data is now nearly everywhere, and often it's a good thing, but it's non-transparent and bears the risk of reinforcing discrimination or even increasing it. A key concern for me is that the data companies are more and more using unique identifiers across different companies, devices, and contexts, which they pretend to be anonymous. Mainly identifiers derived from email addresses and phone numbers. This way, a person can be recognized again as the same person as soon as he or she clicks, swipes, buys, or does some other recorded interaction in real time across networks of data companies. In fact, those identifiers are not anonymous at all, they're pseudonyms. Facebook also uses them. In addition, we've got the identifiers from Google, Apple, and Microsoft, which are more and more replacing the hardware device IDs. And several companies have introduced their own persistent identifiers, for example, Oracle, Axiom, Verizon, Experian, many others, to match and link names, email and postal addresses, phone numbers, cookie IDs, device IDs across data providers and client companies. And both Oracle and Axiom run so-called data management platforms, a kind of real-time online data marketplaces, which allow companies to import data from their customer databases, to match customer IDs, to collect new data, access other data vendors, to analyze and categorize people, they call it segments or audiences, and to find similar people, and finally to send instruction who or where to target people, how to personalize. This way, companies can sort the company, customers into valuable and non-valuable people and into risky and non-risky human beings. Examples of companies running DMPs are Axiom and Oracle, but also Salesforce. Let's have a quick look at Crooks from Salesforce. I'll skip that. They say they allow companies to accurately and anonymously identify unique individuals. One last example, Lotte.me, they provide access to 3 billion cookies and 2 billion mobile device IDs, they say on the website, it's your data. You have the right to control it, share it, and use it how you see fit. Sounds nice, right? But of course, they don't speak to consumers, they speak to their corporate customers.
Exactly.
I think it's a good representation of today's information technology landscape. While we as individuals become more and more transparent, practices of corporate surveillance remain largely obscure. It's not balanced at all. There are several implications of things which can happen to individuals. We will discuss that afterwards. I think for now I will finish, and it's 10 minutes and 10 seconds. It was super fast so far. This is my book. You can also download it for free as a PDF version.
Yes. Thank you very much. Well, if your hair hasn't risen on end so far, you also had a little video to show.
Yes.
Should we shut the light now?
Yeah, we need to
do that. Should we turn the light?
It's really difficult with the video.
But people should see the video.
One example, just one example how companies are marketing these services. This is Factual, a company providing a product which is called Observation Graph. A very nice name, I would say. They're mainly addressing mobile location data and combining it with geographic information, metadata about events. Here we go.
Factual's observation graph technology is a revolutionary way of understanding the real-world behavior of mobile users. With products powered by Observation Graph, you can deliver intelligent mobile experiences. Observation Graph is built on Factual's proprietary global places data, which includes over 90 million local businesses and points of interest in 50 countries and is integrated into leading applications such as Apple Maps, Facebook Places, and Microsoft Bing. Observation Graph also uses demographic data, event data, and other geographic data to fully understand the physical world. All of this data, combined with signals from mobile devices, enables Factual to catalog real-world user behavior. Each day, Observation Graph generates billions of discrete observations globally. Observation Graph powers products that enable advertisers to create highly accurate mobile audiences.
Okay, I would say enough. User ID 987123, activity walking, sounds so innocent, right? What about activity protesting? I guess the Eastern German Stasi would have been really happy to have a tool like that.
Ceausescu as well.
Yes, and as you maybe know, US
don't give Trump any ideas, but they have it already. Yeah. They used it actually.
Yeah. And US police departments have already used data feeds from marketing analytics companies to track protests.
Okay, thank you very much. So that were concrete overview of what the commercial corporations are doing. Now, Jeff, can you tell us a little bit about the political aspects?
Yeah, I mean, I think, and you must all know this, I mean, they have created a global surveillance system that grows without any constraint.
Can you speak louder?
Yeah, they created a global surveillance system that, I mean, these are just, Amy, really, you did a brilliant job at giving you the tiniest slice of what now occurs worldwide, driven principally, in fact, by U.S. companies, but whose business model is adopted globally, including in the EU. And if you haven't looked at exchangewire.com, which just covers the EU market on this, it's useful to do as you follow through. And it's so, you know, I could say more about what's been happening, and Frederick will, about data consolidation and alliances. My organization filed a complaint against this system in 2010 at the Federal Trade Commission. But just to say that it illustrates how in the United States, even under the Obama administration, they're incapable of really dealing with the implications here and have looked the other way. Because what at the FTC and in the United States, in terms of regulation, the advertising practices and the data practices are considered distinct, except in the area of children, where we lobbied to get the Federal Trade Commission to bring the two together. So they consider this ad practices. They don't even look at the privacy implications. So to make a long story short, Oracle and all those companies that Wolf will mention sell their data to political campaigns, sell their data to political parties, sell their data to anyone right now. So what the political campaigns are able to do and the parties are able to do in the UK, in France, and we'll talk just about the United States, and what they are doing. And Obama began it, but it really came to a plateau in the recent election, is they are now integrating in a real-time basis all of this minute-by-minute, second-by-second tracking and analytic data with voter data. Look, this is a system of influence. This is a system of micro-persuasion and influence and behavioral change. It's not really about, and it's cumulative, right? Because they know what you did yet now, what you did 5 minutes ago, what you did in the mobile phone, what you did in your PC, and now with the television. Television is bringing the same system in, right? So there's also programmatic content. The experiences that you face are changed based on all the data and the collection and analysis. And all the political parties, I only have a couple minutes, so I'll make this quick. All the political parties are using this, including progressive parties. Bernie Sanders used these techniques. The Clinton campaign famously spent $1 billion on data analytics. But the person, I think, who used this system to its fullest extent, who really understood, whose people really understood that it's not just about data collection, but it's about changing behavior, was Trump. And Trump, in part, I mean, there was two sources. One was the Republican National Committee, but the other one was Cambridge Analytica. How many of you have heard of Cambridge Analytica, right? I mean, it's become very, very well known because they did Brexit, right? And they're owned by SCL, which is a major a data and marketing and defense a contractor in the UK, who interestingly engages in helping NATO and defense industries engage in psyops. But one of their divisions is politics and political campaigns. And Cambridge Analytica is an affiliate of SCL. So Cambridge Analytica was able to build a database of 220 million Americans and accrue 5,000 data points on each and every American. And I, you know, and in a recent video they did talking about how well they were able to do, I just want to say, so when they gave a presentation a few months ago, and I can't show you this slide because I just, but here's what they used. First place, their partners were Axiom, Experian, Facebook, Aristotle, Nielsen, and they incorporated age, gender, ethnicity, religion, income, health status, and they merged all this data. Because this is what the system is able to do. You're able to merge all this data and do this analysis to identify behaviors and emotion. And they took the data and they analyzed the data using a number of measures, including neuroticism, agreeableness, extroversion. I won't get into it. But they were able to identify the emotional vulnerabilities and characteristics of individuals, especially in the swing states. And they were able to bring those people out, you know, through you could call it disinformation. And they were able to target African Americans and others with content that, remember, the content travels on your PC, on your mobile device, on your television, to target African Americans and others who might have come out for Hillary Clinton and showed them content that would make them less willing to support her. So this system now, it's been totally unregulated, it's been adopted by the political campaigns on all sides, and it's a major, major problem.
Thank you very much. So Frederick, what are the policy solutions?
Well, policy and law and regulators may help a bit, but it will probably be not enough, so there won't be a silver bullet. But the General Data Protection Regulation, GDPR, it makes now explicit. It was always nonsense that such unique numbers were anonymous, but particularly this industry kept on believing that myth, and so the new regulation makes explicit such identifiers are within the scope of European data protection law. It enters into force in 2018. Actually, the most important innovation is that there are competition law type fines possible for breaches of up to 4% of worldwide turnover of a company. This will not have an effect immediately in 2018. But you can imagine and hope, I'm generally a reasonably optimistic person, that you don't find Google or Facebook into bankruptcy or Axiom, but perhaps a fine hits a smaller company once, which falls over immediately. You can imagine that after a few large fines that some companies who knowingly operate in Europe listen more to regulators, so that's some optimism. There's also a new important policy proposal, like 2 weeks ago proposed in Brussels, the e-privacy regulation, which basically adds another layer of privacy measures, especially for the online environment. Generally, the proposal looks pretty good. Now, of course, the lobbying circus starts. Perhaps you could follow it if you're so inclined and if you don't mind reading legalese. But as I said, generally, the proposal is actually surprisingly good. The European Commission did well there. One thing that I will write about and speak about, there's one big missed opportunity. They realized that in the proposal, they realized, like we saw in the video, that your smartphone can be tracked everywhere by listening to your Wi-Fi or Bluetooth signal. The one missed opportunity is that they require full transparency, but they accept an opt-out system, which would mean in practice that in a shopping street they could put on a poster. We track people here based on signals from your phone. If you don't want it, put off your Bluetooth and your Wi-Fi. But it isn't practical, and I think it would make more sense to have that only on consent, which I admit would mean that in most public spaces people probably wouldn't consent, so these companies wouldn't get your consent, but I could live with that. Or another possibility is that you allow it if it's immediately aggregated, because I can imagine that say on New Year's or in Holland on King's Day, when there's a million people extra in Amsterdam, it is useful for tracking which neighborhoods are super crowded and where you etc. But you can do that less invasive. So e-privacy proposals, good idea, some bad bits, but I warn again, it only law will not solve everything. It's like we have environmental law now for, let's say, 60 years. The environment is not saved. I'm completely sure we would have been worse off without environmental law. So it's good that we keep on trying and pushing. But it's not that one proposal will ever solve the problem. It will remain pushing, and then there will remain failures, like the Volkswagen scandal, although we had environmental law and standards, etc. So it's not a battle that will be finished with one proposal, but I'm optimistic that policymakers, nudged by people like you, will continue to push back. And there will also be lost battles, but also small won battles.
Well, you're making me very happy. Right, I have a follow-up question to all of you, and then I'll open it up for more general discussion. Wolfie, you've given us lots and lots of concrete research examples of practices. Putting my corporate hat on, if I heard all this, I will say, so, you know, where's the harm? It's a more efficient way to raise revenue than in the old days, and it's providing you with free services all over the place. So why are you objecting so much? They're not hiding it. All those videos you are showing, they are perfectly there for everybody to see. What's the problem?
It's a very good question. And first of all, sometimes they are hiding it, because when they're saying they're using anonymous data and so on, this is a kind of hiding for me. And they also hide much of the details of what they really collect and how they analyze data and so on. But if you look at an old old practices of credit scoring, which are existing since centuries, people are affected, negatively affected by that. When they have a bad credit score, they then don't have access to many opportunities and many choices. This is the same in Europe and also in Germany and Austria, where I come from, even more in the US, where you don't get a job anymore, or you can't rent a flat anymore, and so on. So this is really affecting people. On the other hand, when I look at, for example, the platforms like Google, Facebook, Airbnb, Amazon, or whatever, today it's like sometimes they just delete an account of somebody because of some combination of issues, fraud, too many returns, whatever. There is no way to object against this. There is no accountability. There is, I know what all these companies are working on. They're working on to use the data from the data marketing data ecosystem to make decisions in other fields of life. And so we know where they want to go. And so I'm sure we've got this massive problem. Still remaining is the issue that this is all such an abstract thread.
Yeah.
And I think this is one of the most important challenges, how to tell about these issues in a way that it's understandable. Because surveillance is not about, as Katarzyna from Panopticon, is she here? No. Once said, it's not about knowing your secrets. It's about managing people, managing populations.
Controlling.
It's very controlling populations. It's much more abstract.
Okay, thank you. Do any of you have additional questions or remarks on this particular point? Yes, please.
Actually, a particular remark to what GDPR is going to provide us in that field. I mean, one thing is the possibilities for litigation and everything. There are some good news also going on in Austria. I cannot talk too much about now, he's not here, but Max Schrems is going to institutionalize what he did so far with Facebook and make it broader and everything, so you will hear soon from that. So that's a good news. He's working a long time on that, and we need a lot of litigation. But there is another problem that I see. I was Christoph Troll, my name from Austria, from Acra Forad, or also now Epicenter Works. I was appointed now in the last half year of the Austrian Workers' Chamber, Arbeiterkammer, to elaborate first a study and combined with a draft law on how we can regulate on national level the topic of credit scoring, of profiling for credit scoring. And one of the big things what we see there and big problems as a result of the study is it is very unclear and also very narrow what member states are still allowed to do.
Yeah.
Yeah? So what Article 22 provides is also the right to object. The right to object is just limited in Article 21 to the cases of profiling for advertising reasons. Yeah? So as in the moment when the profiling is not done for the mere marketing reasons, but really for credit scoring, you cannot object under the basic rules of Article 21, where you have to give a reason, but not anymore an objection without any reason. The next thing is,
yeah.
It is absolutely unclear how much this, let's say, scoring agencies can be ruled for more transparency, for disclosing their algorithms. A lot of stuff regarding also the question how you can do some law enforcement in that part and so on. So what would be extremely helpful is, of course, from Article 29 Working Party or the Council then later, but from every level, from no matter where, from the Commission particularly, to have some more space there to find to some way where we see at least the member states should have the space, those who are willing to do, to put more regulation, to put more limitation. Because if we leave that to the free market and the litigation, I don't think that we will really keep up in that race.
Fully agree.
Mm-hmm. Okay, do you want to comment on that? I think I've got two more people. Yes, Katerina.
Yeah,
can you focus on this issue specifically,
yeah, so
and then we'll
the
go.
Question
yeah.
On, so why do we care? And I mean, I'm not saying anything that's new to anybody, but I think connecting it to the discussion from this morning, I think as a community would be, I think, really important to emphasize the discussion on value. So if it is an efficiency argument that the industry is making, we need to say, well, but there are other values, right? There's the issue of equity. And so if we keep on doing this, sorting people according to their value or their risk to the companies, we end up with a society with more inequality. And so that's not, you know, obviously that's a big concern and an increasing concern. So I think the discussion from autonomy and privacy has to be sort of drawn to also address those other issues.
Yeah.
So that's why we're doing
this. I think also in the research, that in the US, there's been research done on impact on ethnic groups and lower income groups, for example, with targeting subprime mortgages at them.
Payday loans,
yeah.
Health problems, junk food. There are practices.
Well,
there are practices totally
well,
connected that show harms. That, but you're right. Yeah.
So I think these are very good examples. But this is, as you said, this is sort of a pervasive. This is a constantly happening. It's not just on one particular product, but it's a constant sort of how people experience their world differently. The opportunities that are being presented are different than people have, you know, more assets and so forth. So I think we need to have more research on this, more understanding, so that we can talk about this, what these impacts are. And this is the really on the focus on the use of the data. And just to add on that, it's also not just whether it's personal data or pseudonymous or anonymous data, it's really the whole machine and how the data is
used. And completely unregulated there.
I hear Jeff's concern about what U.S. companies are doing here in Europe, but I think it would be
a mistake to think that European companies aren't doing the same.
I didn't say that. They are doing it, but they've adopted the U.S.
Wolfie, you pointed to LexisNexis, which is a division of Reed Elsevier. They're a European company doing this. They have, in addition to what you showed us, one of their divisions is something called Accurint, which was originally developed for the part of the U.S. Total Information Awareness Program. Hmm. Reed Elsevier's Accurint division is the provider of ID information, ID verification information that U.S. Homeland Security and the TSA uses to decide whether to let you on an airplane in the U.S. based on this aggregated commercial database. So this is happening with European companies too. Amadeus, the European-based airline reservation system, is not only compiling this data, but has this grossly leaky system where they plugged in public web gateways that any stalker can find out your travel itinerary from your baggage tag. I reported this vulnerability to them 15 years ago. They never did anything. Nor did any of the European enforcement agencies do anything. And so this is my question for the Europeans in the room. What is the point of talking about policies when there is zero enforcement of existing European laws? Why did Schrems have to sue? One, why didn't the data protection authorities do anything? And two, why aren't there more Schrems? Why did Schrems have to sue, and why aren't there more of him? Please, can anybody tell me?
I would just answer yes.
So right, I got one answer on this particular question. Anybody from the audience? Yes.
The second question you should ask Max, but the first question is that part of why Max had to show was a great deal of the question of whether the data protection supervisors have competence in his problem or not. And the big breakthrough in Max's case initially was only about competence whatsoever, and then the court went completely further than anyone, including Max, expected and said, well, this whole safe harbor thing is bollocks and is now null and void. That's the very short and slightly impolite version of it.
That's all right. This is filmed, remember?
I'm Dutch. I'm totally. This would be depriving me totally that identity if I had to tongue down my language. Yeah.
This is the polite version.
But basically, since this was contested area, competence-wise, and regulators tend to take, trying not to be seen as overstepping the boundaries of their competence. So that makes it simple. And basically, post-range, the Hamburg DPA started enforcing the lack of safe harbor in their jurisdiction. So it's, well, I do agree with your general criticism of the European supervisory authorities. They actually do something. So it's not fair to say zero. It's not enough, definitely. There's not enough resources either. But you can't say, especially based on the Schrems case, that they're just completely useless losses, as you were implying, by saying they're doing zero. But that's not true. Even ICO, which is after the Luxembourgish
that's
and the
Irish
DPAs, are the third most useless DPAs in Europe, even ICO, just from enforcement action. So it's not entirely fair.
Can we push back on more?
Yeah, hang on. Let's have... I think Frederick wants to respond,
yeah,
and then you can come back.
I agree there's a dramatic lack of enforcement, but that's also a bit inherent to the privacy problem. It reminds a bit of certain consumer protection rules. So privacy is about often a kind of abstract threat that hurts millions of people a bit, and then layer on layer on layer. But just like in consumer law, if you buy a pen and it doesn't work, nobody sues. And then there's two possibilities, basically. If there's company behavior that hurts basically the whole society, you can make a system for class action suits, like in the US, that helps sometimes, but it doesn't solve all the problems. Or you can put a regulator in place, which helps sometimes, but doesn't solve all the problems. And now there's personal data flying around our laptops and out of our smartphones and watches every second, and these poor regulators, some should do more their best, but on the other hand, they're not that big. They should try to enforce those rules in the whole society. So it will remain difficult to enforce such rules, but in an optimistic mood, you could say, at least with the new rules, there will be serious possibilities for fines, and there will be somewhat clunky, but possibilities for class action suits also in Europe. In a pessimistic mood, you could also say regulators will never have enough manpower. But I'm in an optimistic mood.
Can I emphasize this point of class action you just mentioned? In my experience as a consumer rights activist, people can only complain about things that they know about and directly affects them. A lot of the stuff you described is going on. The vast majority of people have no idea it's going on. So the question is, to you and the audience, how do you communicate it effectively? And this on this issue of enforcement and class action, you need not a complaints-based system, but an investigation-based system. Katerina mentioned research. And the class action in order for the organizations that do this research to actually take action on it. Isn't that a way to slightly improve the situation?
Well, I think that one of the top of the agenda here for civil society and US groups want to help is to use the GDPR to address all these problems, including this system. I mean, this is now the dominant way that advertising and marketing, and now we know political campaigns, operate around the world. Right, just about 5 years ago, this was a relatively small part of how it all worked. Now, the fact that you are sold, or ignored, you're sold to the highest bidder in 20, or now 10 milliseconds, right, for all these things. People need to know about it, but we need to push the DPAs, you need to push this regulatory structure. You need to go after Google and Facebook, because it's true, all the companies are doing it here. I think, in part, the U.S. companies play an extraordinary role in refining this business model, which has to be adopted by everybody, because that's the way the business works. So we hope that you will use the GDPR, because even if Clinton had won, nothing would have happened in the United States about all this. So this surveillance aspect, this dehumanization system they've created to buy and sell us and ignore us, that reinforces discrimination, will continue to grow unless you guys fight it.
May I just a short addition?
You
to
and
that,
then Frederick, yeah.
To the problem of class actions. I mean, GDPR does provide for organizations to sue and so on, but GDPR does not provide for a real system of class actions.
That's
there.
True. Yeah,
right.
And that is actually a problem with, what is maybe not
yeah,
so
okay.
much public, that Max Schrems at the moment, since more than 1 year, is also fighting in the, he brought the class action or a kind of class action to the Austrian Court of Commerce, and there, which is pending at the moment at the European Court of Justice, and there we have the problem, as many other civil process codes in Europe, that we do not provide for a system of class actions. So in this case, what we can do, we can try to go for class actions in US, but on which substantial level and so on. So it's a matter of international private law, maybe also. So that is not really helpful in that case. So we also need, I think, better instruments for this kind of litigation.
Yeah, perhaps minimum damages.
Yep.
For like 50 euro a person, whatever, because it's really hard to prove to a judge that you have any financial. Generally, class action suits generally stumble in the US because the judges say you can't prove financial harm,
that's
right?
One of the two major difficulties, right? Monetizing, three, monetizing certainty is essential, right? So speculative harm is very much distrusted.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And the third is the interests of the class members need to be identical. That's a change from 20 years ago.
Yeah.
But in order to narrow the scope of class actions, we now require practically identity of interest.
Mm.
Used to be you could litigate the issue of principle and then discuss damages, and that's become much harder.
And do you think it has helped a bit in consumer protection law or in privacy law, or that is that basically all the teeth are taken out of this tiger?
Most of the teeth.
Oh, sad.
I mean, and indeed, there's a question as to whether it had teeth to begin with, because so many of the settlements really went to the lawyers. Now, that certainly didn't benefit the consumers directly. The interim effect may have had some value, but that itself is an issue my colleagues argue about.
Okay, so it seems setting up regulators better path to follow.
The difficulty with that is it's subject to variation in enthusiasm.
Yeah.
I mean, if you look at the history of privacy commissioners in, say, France, for example, enormous enthusiasm difference over time.
Okay, so that was on class action. Any more comments, questions around the room, particularly on the enforcement issue and actually related?
Yeah.
Yes, please. Can you identify yourself?
I'm Gerd Kupe. I'm working as data protection officer, and I'm a big fan of the GDPR because I like the penalties, because I see the penalties are a big sword that you can use in combination with the transparency. And you are somebody that you said we have to wait until there are big clauses against companies. And
it helps already.
But I think that we don't have to wait. We have to enforce now these clauses because we have this right for transparency. And if now we use this right of transparency at the 5th of 2018 very excessively, we get a lot of companies what are standing without trousers.
Mm-hmm.
And they say, oops, we haven't done our homework.
Yeah.
And I think that with showing now the high possibility that these action from the community or from the activist part is possible, that this is a possible risk for all companies, this helps inside of companies to argue for data protection officers, for example, that they got more budget, that they have more room for decisions, and it helps to improve the whole level of data protection.
Agree.
And you know, these programmatic structures are happening in every country in the EU, right? And that's what's great about ExchangeWire, by the way, because, here are all the companies from Germany, here are all the companies from Netherlands, here's all the companies from France, right? They even publish the maps, right? Here are all the so you can identify those DPAs can identify the country specific companies that are all doing what was just said and go after them.
Yes, but when follow up, for example, I did also some research on German companies, especially there are many data companies belonging to the Bertelsmann corporation and to Schober and so on, and this is all. They're doing basically the same stuff. They're using this kind of pseudonymous identifiers and so on, and there is also no enforcement in the great data protection country, Germany. And they have strong lobbies, and for example, when I look at the GDPR, I always have to say, I'm sorry, I'm not a lawyer, so for me it's difficult, but if I see that direct marketing is, for example, listed as a legitimate interest for companies to collect data about consumers, and also network security and fraud detection, because I've seen that data from network security and fraud detection and marketing data sphere is also merging. I'm a bit, I don't feel very well.
Look, I think one thing I did leave out. Another way into this is, in fact, fake news. Because, and I should have mentioned this, because the fake news system is really driven by this programmatic advertising, right? This dispersed system. So these guys can, create this content, and they monetize it. And it wasn't until after the Trump election, 2 weeks, that Google put some rules in around its use of DoubleClick and fake news. So looking at the role that fake news plays in country and the programmatic system is also one way to raise awareness in terms of developing a policy initiative.
Okay, yes.
I have to add something.
Yes, do.
Because I think that companies have to be enforced, but also our DPAs, so the authorities, has to be enforce to enforce.
Yeah, exactly what I'm saying. Right.
Which means we have to help them as our partners, but they don't have the right to have arguments. No, we can't because we have so less people. So then the difficult situation that they don't have all the resources what they are need. So I'm sure that we as activists have to make them as a convenient food, that they have a clause where everything is prepared. They just go to the company and have to look whether the findings from outside are correct, and then see.
One quick remark to Wolfie, don't worry, specialized lawyers also find the data protection regulation difficult.
On this issue, hang on.
Interested to the direct marketing.
On this issue of enforcement, you mentioned the DPAs, you mentioned the law, litigation, etc., all quite remote from ordinary people. What about the media? There is a dilemma with the media because they use this system to make money. What about them? How do you... it's a question to the panel and the audience generally, yes. You and then Edward, yeah.
So I'm sure that media is interested in stories, and big penalties against somebody is a big story. So at least, and if this is, for example, we didn't have these high sues in history, so this is something new, and I'm sure that this is something, when you have the right storyline behind it, that the media is using it for transportation.
As a journalist, as someone who got involved in consumer advocacy as a journalist, I think you need to distinguish the interests of media companies from the interests of journalists. And the best way, if you want good journalists, I think, is to support independent journalists self-publishing, because that's where the real investigatory work is being done these days. So that's a different question for copyright advocacy as to how to have an economic structure that supports independent self-publishing journalists economically. But I also, in terms of enforcement, there's one other body, and that's the European Commission. You know, the airline reservation systems are subject, in addition to the general data protection rules, to the Code of Conduct for Computerized Reservation Systems, which specifically provides jurisdiction directly to the European Commission. They have never had a single enforcement action. They have resources. Amadeus is there are only three reservation systems. There's only one based in Europe, Amadeus. If there's anybody in the European Commission charged with enforcement looking at that code of conduct, the first thing they would have done is look at Amadeus. And if they spent 5 minutes, they would see that it's grossly insecure. I stand by what I said. There are European institutions with unquestioned jurisdiction and resources that have chosen to do nothing.
It's interesting, I just want to say, in terms of journal, I'm also a former journalist, the New York Times, I work the press, I'm responsible for most of the stories that came out about this system in the last 5-6 years. I placed them. And the reporter now responsible for this told me, who works in advertising, that they've not been able to really report on it now because there's conflicts in the Times, but fake news and how fake news changed the election, and fake news is happening in Germany and all that, has created a window where they're now able to write about this system for the first time. So maybe it's something we can take advantage of.
Can I ask a follow-up question? Yes, in a minute, Walter. I need to ask a follow-up question on the political aspects. Why is this such a big issue, putting my, campaign manager of Trump hat on?
Mm-hmm.
Why is this such a big issue when political parties have always campaigned? They go door to door and they talk to people with leaflets, and they would say to you, well, this is just a more efficient system to reach the people that would vote for us anyway. How would you answer that?
Look, I think that it's never been used. Look, it's a continuation of what advertising and politics have been doing and public relations have been doing for decades. And I'd love to talk to you guys about it. But they've never had the ability. They've taken this system to engage in micro persuasion in behavioral change. I mean, if you look at part of look, there's the data stuff of programmatic, but there's the ad creative of programmatic. And the ad creative of programmatic involves testing the message using neuromarketing. And if you look at neuromarketing in the EU or look at neuromarketing in the US, it's a major industry that's exploded that in a way is part of this programmatic system. They test the messages to purposely bypass the conscious mind, right? I mean, there's neuromarketing firms being used by all these big media companies, political groups in the Netherlands, and Germany, and Italy, and everywhere. So they're able to use all the data about you. They're now able to track you device to device, application to application, because they've created this seamless way of following you device to device, including television now, and they're able to combine it with an emotional analysis to get you to do what they want you to do. Now, for some people it works, for others it might not work, but the cumulative impact of this system, artificial intelligence, cognitive advertising, look at IBM Watson's new advertising division, all of the 3D video, immersive video, all these things coming together to influence you to buy brands, products, politicians, ideas, values.
Thank you. Walter, you wanted to say something. On this
part. Oh, Walter.
your question was basically what our normal citizens would do.
Can you speak louder?
Sorry, your earlier question, what can an average citizen do that does not necessarily have access to?
Yeah. Oh, so you're going back to that. Okay.
I think generally I'm in love with the privacy cafes or the crypto parties, or however you want to brand them, because it gives a sense of empowerment to people who don't necessarily have access to courts and complex procedures. And it actually is starting to hurt your ecosystem. Look what the ad blockers are doing to, I mean, whole DMT debate kind of petered out, and now industry is sort of coming back. Hang on. We are feeling the pain of a loss of trust in the general public because of the mass adoption of ad blockers. For different reasons, some for privacy, so just for some for people losing their data bundles or the battery of their mobile being eaten away, the more aware thing that there are multiple factors in this loss of trust. But this loss of trust does translate into individually actionable actions, and individuals are taking that action. Regardless of age, young people do it more often than.
That's a good point.
But can
it
I
wasn't,
respond?
Yes, of course.
Yeah.
It hasn't been raised before, the technologies that help people and they're expanding. Can you comment on
that? I'm more cynical
that?
About it because, yes, okay, the industry's shocked about ad blockers. but what they've done is this, and it's a problem, and I'm glad that my daughter uses all that, right? I mean, I like to see the ads because I need to be tracked. That's how I make my living, right? No, but the fact that what they did was this: they developed another approach, which they call native advertising, which allows them to simply embed the branding message within the content, right? Which cannot be blocked. That's how, in fact, your perspective will be filtered. They are finding ways around it. So I don't think that, I think it's a mistake to think that individuals, even at a mass scale, can stop this system without regulatory intervention.
Oh, that was not what I was claiming.
I know I wasn't,
but the question was, what can an individual, basically a regulatory intervention is not something an average citizen easily can achieve. It is more what we need to complement our activism and make our activism more relevant, and that's why I love the privacy cafes, because they give people a sense of agency. Even though it's limited, it's an arms race.
No, I think it's important.
And I will not want to compete on your cynicism.
No. I think it's important. But look at programmatic native, if you have a chance, right? So what they did was they created this native advertising, which is just product placement, and now they're able to deliver it in milliseconds. The ad that's really disguised as content, you know, targeted to your profile, that bypasses those blockers.
Frederick, you wanted to comment on this?
Yeah, pessimistic remark now. So we look at the surveillance system built for online ads. Actually, it is still, by and large, online advertising is pretty innocent. It's becoming a lot more troublesome if the online advertising bubble bursts, if imagine that some well, it won't burst in one time, but it may inflate a bit or strongly, that large advertisers at one point say, you know what, I don't believe all this digital marketing talk anymore, all the targeting billboards or non-targeted ads work fine as well, then we may be in a lot bigger problems, because these companies are basically obliged to the shareholders to make money, and then they will have to search even harder for new ways to monetize those piles of data they sit on. It's somewhat hypothetical, I said, pessimistic, but Facebook could use their data, an evil Facebook could use their data for goals a lot more troublesome than online advertising, even than political advertising.
But also,
yeah. I'm not saying this is generally unproblematic, eh, the current system, but it could be way worse if you see the piles of data they sit on.
Well, presumably it is already way worse if it's used by a totalitarian regime.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
On the one hand, I agree with very much what you said. On the one hand, I see a kind of concentration process. All the big company corporations are buying the most successful players of this kind of ad tech and marketing tech ecosystems and so on. And on the other hand, a second thing, and this is, it's a very difficult thing. No matter if we're talking about persuasive behavioral advertising, behavioral change in the commercial sphere, or maybe even in the political sphere, I think we also have to be at the same time careful to not just I don't know how to say it. The companies who are marketing their stuff, also like Cambridge Analytica, they are really trying to make themselves as very important players.
Yeah.
So we are so powerful. They say it openly. We can do anything. We can change your mind. We won maybe probably the Trump's election and so on. And I think we have to be careful. On the one hand, it's a big problem. I've been investing lots of work in all these kinds of stuff. On the other hand, we shouldn't just believe everything what these companies are saying, how things are working and how good they are working. Because very often, I believe they don't. It doesn't mean that they are not working on it to make it better.
Okay, I think somebody else in the audience wants to speak, and then you can have a word. Yes, please.
Okay, so I'm sorry, I wanted to go back to what Walter was saying beforehand about ad blockers. So,
okay, ad blockers.
Yeah, so a very important point is that there are a lot of users who are under the mistaken impression that when they install an ad blocker that the tracking ends. So, for example, I think this is something that, you know, organizations and people, it is true that installing an ad blocker or a tracker blocker better is a kind of a first act by a user, which kind of, you know, can be a first step in actually terms of understanding what is going on in this environment. You know, you showed also, was it Lightscape or, you know, some of the other
Lightbeam,
some of the other add-ons for browsers which have been designed so as to produce this sense of awareness. So I mean, I think that this is a very important area for another reason as well, which is that if you can convey to people the importance of stopping tracking as opposed to just stopping advertising, because I don't think that the advertising is ever going to go away, and I don't think that it's going to be possible to fund actually a lot of the stuff that exists online at the moment without the advertising system. So the advertising system needs to be reformed massively so that it actually serves and respects users, right? Now, I mean, tracker blockers have the possibility to also generate a market for privacy compliant products. So, I mean, you know, all of this stuff has been out there for quite a long time. For example, how to do advertising targeting without tracking the users, how to do analytics without, you know what I mean, tracking the user's click stream. All of this stuff has existed, in theoretical formats in university projects in very small companies which don't have any significant clients and therefore don't have any market oxygen, and they've existed for a long, you know, this stuff has existed for a long time, but we haven't really made the step to actual products that are getting into, you know, the mass market and into users' hands. I think this is a very important area, because once you seed a competition, and I'm not, you know, some sort of market fundamentalist, you know what I mean, but I think we know that in the United States we're not going to see the regulation. And I think that we see in Europe that what regulation we get is both, it's not sufficient, and it's also very, very slow. And there's this constant kind of catch-up process. So while people were chasing cookies for years, then suddenly it was, you know, about device fingerprinting and about cross-device, you know, identification, or about super cookies, or about, you know, all of the new, you know, local storage and HTML5. It's this constant, you know, arms race. And, you know, so if we can create actually a competitive situation whereby there are people who are producing privacy products that have gone to market, then the situation suddenly starts to look different, because users have some defense.
Yeah. Actually, those are very good points, and it also occurs to me, we've been talking about privacy laws. What about consumer laws? I mean, some of the practices described could be taken to be unfair commercial practices,
mm-hmm.
Could be misleading advertising. I mean, potentially you could use different kind of laws to follow them, wouldn't you? I mean, yeah.
In the US,
we made that
it
case,
gives
but
the FTC,
basically have not followed it.
It gives the FTC some power, which in Europe we do have consumer law. There should probably be more help and synchronizing. Still, I think for the moment, I went especially to some consumer law conferences. I thought, now I'm going to hear how professionals do enforcement. And basically every second talk was about, sadly, we have all these good rules, but we don't enforce them.
Yeah,
so it's not that consumer lawyers can learn data privacy lawyers how to arrange enforcement. Actually, most of them are looking now amazed at data protection policy, where there's suddenly such serious fines. So the solution is not there yet, ready, but there should be more interaction and contact between the policy areas.
One specific question to this. For example, when we use a smartphone nowadays, then we just have the option to choose between using it with a Google account, Apple account, or Microsoft account. There is no other option, except for people who are really technically aware. How could this be addressed? So we don't have a choice.
You want more competing smartphone?
We just can use it with an account from Google, from Apple, or from Microsoft when we want to use a normal phone.
Systems.
State of the art phone.
Well, it's a competition issue, isn't it?
Yes.
Have one more question, because we are nearing the end and then we're going to wrap up. We talked a lot about the corporations and the political use and the commercial use. What about beneficial use? There are a lot of social behavioral advertising, like, you know, making people eat healthy diets to stop heart disease, and making them stop smoking, and, you know, trying to stop obesity in childhood. And they could use the same technology, and it would be good for society, wouldn't it? Any comments on that? So what's good for the gander is good for the goose as well.
I wanted to add the leading corporations, their business model, this is why it's not more, not just advertising, their business model is now, in their own words, identity curation. They understand them in this system, they need to be able to understand and connect to you 24/7. So there's been a major shift in the corporate structure. So this first, second, and third party data, right? That's all now merged together. It's about understanding who you are more in order to have a lifelong relationship and sell to you. And clearly the political parties are doing this too. So it transcends advertising systems. Look, I don't think this is a system about discrimination where the harms will dominate,
okay.
You know, its delivery. We should not rely on it to help people, you know, get through their lives better.
Okay, hang on, I've got a member of the audience who wants to say something.
On your question, what about
social?
The question that I have to ask is, who defines what is good? Because if you ask, for example, the Turkish prime minister, he has another.
That's a very good answer.
That is opposition.
Yeah.
So it's very, very difficult to define what is good and what is not good. And if you look at the constitutions, then most times the constitutions leave this open. They say everyone has to make up his mind and he has the right to do so. And this social advertisement is trying to imprint a common ethical view of things. The question is that the right way? Who is authorized to define the common ethical way?
Very good point. Very good point. Yes.
Yes, I would also agree. And it's also important for me, I'm not very sure where you're talking about, for example, using the programmatic ecosystem, pervasive tracking to put these messages out. Or were you talking about all these, fitness trackers and connected cars where people are kind of openly tracked and use it voluntarily, join these programs to
reduce their costs?
Because it's different stories, I think. The first thing to manipulate people to get them act, healthier or less risky, or maybe employers who want to get the employees to work faster, things like that, then no.
Yeah.
I would say no. On the other hand, when we're talking about all these fitness tracker programs, this usage-based insurance programs, which involves tracking the car driving behavior and so on, here we will get really a problem, I think, because really many people join these programs completely voluntary in the moment. As long as it's really voluntarily, I don't have a problem with it. But the problem is, for example, in Germany, Generali insurance started also now to offer a policy involving Fitbit fitness tracker and so on. And you get discounts for your life insurance about 20%. So for the premiums. So this is pretty much. And when it gets so much that people who are economically vulnerable
will do it.
Will maybe have to do it because, I can't afford this without using the fitness tracker product and so on, then we'll get the problem. The same thing is, for example, with all these modern new credit scoring startups. Which are using mobile phone data and social network data and so on. They're also voluntary in the moment. But one last sentence.
Because I got two more people and we ran out of
time. The danger for me is really that in future it could happen when we don't do anything, that kind of the poor will be governed per machines and via machines, and they have to open up all their private life to these companies. And people who can afford privacy, they can afford it.
Well, you paint a very nice future, thank you. yes, you wanted to say something and then, you first, No, you, yes. Sorry, I don't know your name. Okay.
So I guess maybe this is sort of just a theoretical, like a very theoretical viewpoint on this that sort of also is pulling things to a sort of like extreme. But in some ways, this is sort of a question, really, of the, especially with regards to the political targeting, with the quest, with the relationship between the private sector and the state.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, sort of this task of surveillance, which has historically been one that the state has done, and with statistics sort of emerging as the state science, in recent times we have, like, the state has been okay with private actors taking this up, because there was money to be made, and the state, you know, looked upon this very favorably, and also was able to use the information. But now, when you, for instance, look at how the German government is watched what happened in the United States and also in the United Kingdom, and is realizing, oh no, like, this can actually be used to perhaps undermine a specific understanding of democracy, then this really has this potential for this sort of adversarial notion of who has the right to know, the state or private companies. And with what regards to what I think you said earlier about, like, fostering a market environment in which tools would sort of come about which can handle this well, this is perhaps also where the state can step in and quite perhaps, say, fund open source tools, you know, to the tune of, like, large sums of money, to be able to do this and educate people in doing this thing. Because otherwise, what this, and this, of course, is something that I don't think that many of the states, at least in Europe, will be so quite keen to do so quickly.
Yeah.
But the issue is that they're coming to this sort of fork in the road where it may be either that or losing a sort of true democracy, however you want to define
that.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, yes, I agree.
Mm-hmm.
You want it?
You said it won't be okay if it's voluntarily. And I would like to object a little bit, because the voluntarily is a very, very difficult situation, because even if you say, I don't want to participate, this is even information itself that it may be sensible.
Yes.
And that everyone, that your neighbors are doing it and you are not, is also declassifying you.
Mm.
So this is very big problem. If and we have to do something about that too.
Mm-hmm.
I think.
Yes,
yeah.
An additional good argument.
Okay, we've now over time. Can I? Yeah, you, and then I'll ask the panel for two sentences on a conclusion. I think, yeah, we've got till 12:45.
Oh, sorry.
But nobody's chasing us out, so we might as well. Okay,
just
yes.
Very briefly, as an idea to everybody who has some ideas of litigation or doing litigation connected with the question of value, and also with this topic of free will. We have in civil law, of course, voluntarily contracting on both sides, but as the European civil law, continental Europe, civil law is raising from Roman law, we have one figure, I think, that almost all civil orders have in common. This is the figure of the so-called lesio enormis. It means that if one side is giving its part to a contract, and the let's say the what you receive from that, if this is not even half of the value of what was given to it, the contract might be void. Yeah? So if we now, in a lot of contracts, pay with data, we pay with data everywhere. Yeah? So we would have seriously assess somehow what is the value for us. You can see this is the rabat, you get 10% or whatever, and we would have to see on the opposite what is the value for the company. And if there we can make it, we can somehow anchor it on some kind of objective, more or less objective assessment of the value of this, we can bring this into litigation. So we were going to do this ourselves in the next possible occasion of litigation, and I encourage everybody to do this if you have this figure in
so
your...
So everybody litigate, yes. Okay, can I ask the panel to...
Yeah, I'm going to basically thank the audience for coming. I don't want to keep you from lunch, so thank you.
If anyone's going to tackle this commercial surveillance system, it has to come from you in Europe. Right, with the GDPR and your human rights framework. And one possible tool could be continuing to go after the privacy shield, because all the US companies are in fact doing these things here we just talked about and exporting the data using the shield.
Well, now you put on our shoulders not only arranging, making things better in Europe, but also
No, the shield is allowing them to to bypass European data law.
So more responsibility for us.
Yeah.
Okay.
Unfortunately, I'm a bit pessimistic. Until a year ago, my horror vision was a kind of soft power, Brave New World thing, where we are nudged into acting, well behaving, and so on. Now all this authoritarian stuff is coming back. I'm not sure. The corporate surveillance system is really a problem, but it's very new. It's just 10 years old. And I think we should really work on to reboot parts of our information technology ecosystems to get a democratic information society.
Okay, well, thank you very much
to
everybody and all the contributors.
You.
Can you give a round of applause?